evening session with Richard Foster is just one part of 3 days that we have three morning chapels with Richard in Edmond Chapel. My name is Steve Kello. I'm the chaplain of the college. Students call me Chappy K. You can call me that if you want. At first, when they started calling me that, I thought it might have been a little irreverent. But I've come to see it as a term of endearment, and I hope that I'm not just fooling myself about that. But this event this evening is co-sponsored by Wheaton College and InterVarsity Press, the publishers of Richard's newest book, Sanctuary of the Soul. I want to explain the book table in the back has Richard's books there. I'm not sure how many of his books are there, but many of his titles are available there, and they're available at a 30% discount, which is a nice opportunity for you. I want to explain the format of our time. The first half hour will just be conversational between Richard and myself. I have a whole list of questions for him. Worked hard at these questions, some real stompers. And then after about a half hour, then we open the floor to you to ask questions and have dialogue with Richard about his book, Sanctuary of the Soul, or the theme of this week, the With God Life, or whatever you want to talk about. Before we begin, I want to read just a couple of verses of scripture. Last Friday, I spoke in chapel, and I spoke on Luke 11, and on the theme of prayer and what it means to be an apprentice in prayer, an apprentice to Jesus in prayer. I chose to speak. I have a theme this year on being apprentices, being disciples of Jesus, following Jesus, teaching on discipleship in the scriptures. And I decided that somewhere along the line, I would speak on being an apprentice in prayer. And so I decided I would speak on that before Richard Foster came, not after he came. So I got that out of the way. But the text that I spoke on last week is one that I pondered a lot and really leads to our conversation this evening. One day, Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray." And so that's the attitude, the spirit that we come to our gathering this evening with in looking to the Lord to teach us something more about prayer. Let me lead us in a word of prayer before we get our conversation going. Great God and loving Father, we come to you this evening seeking an awareness of your presence, seeking to glorify you with our thoughts, to learn from you, from your Holy Spirit, from your word. We come seeking to be encouraged in our faith, and we pray that by your Spirit and through our time together this evening, that we might find your ministering to our hearts and your speaking words to us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. First question. I'm always interested in book titles, and I know that sometimes the actual title of a book was not the author's idea, but the publisher's idea. How was it that we came about the title of your new book, Sanctuary of the Soul?
Well, Bob and Alice, now, do you want to tell them how you came up with this title? No. First, let me just say thank you for being here tonight. I told Steve, you know, it just may be you and me and the gatepost, but here you are, and how nice. No, that's a title. Just thinking about meditative prayer and what that is. And we had in our home, Catherine Helmers, who works as an agent, and talking together about this task, this book, this idea. And out of the conversation came this idea that this is the aspect of prayer that can lead us into an inner sanctuary of the soul. where the heart, a portable sanctuary, where the heart can be open to the Lord. And IVP folk were so gracious that actually took it. I mean, they didn't suggest, you know, the sex life of the American pastor or something. You know, it would sell better that way. But that's how, I mean, when you think of a center, a sanctuary, but within, and that meditative prayer moves us in that inward direction. So that's where the title came
from.
All right. Yeah.
Then when you open the book, you find that there's a dedication. Many people don't pay any attention to those dedications, but I do. Could you tell us something about William Luther Vaswick, who you call a man of prayer and best friend?
Yes. When I first pastored, you know, out of seminary, and I'm ready to conquer the world, at least by tomorrow, and I went to pastor a little church that would rank as a marginal failure on the ecclesiastical scoreboards. I mean, it was awful. The conservatives, they were mad at the liberals. The liberals, they were mad at the radicals. The radicals, God bless them, they were just mad. I think half that congregation had the gift of discouragement. So there I was. And down the street was the largest Lutheran church, certainly in Southern California. It was in the whole valley. Everybody knew about Shepherd of the Valley Lutheran Church. Well, I go to, you know, these pastors' association meetings. It was awful. And there was another person there, Bill Voswick, who had exactly the same reaction. And we were drawn toward one another, although we were from very different backgrounds. So I asked him to speak to our elders. Safe, get a Lute to come and talk to your elders. And he did. And because it was a group that none of his congregation would, you know, connect with, he opened up about certain things going on. His son had been diagnosed as an incurable schizophrenic, and the process and some of what he'd gone through with Philip. And I listened to that. This morning I told a little story about the first time I went to his church and hid up in the balcony and heard this little old lady speak about prayer. And so I went to Bill and I said, Bill, you know a whole lot more about prayer than I do. Would you teach me everything you know? And that was the beginning of a lifelong friendship. And we would meet together. The way Bill would teach about prayer, for the most part, was by praying. Let me just give a little example. We were talking one time, you know, about the Philippians 2:19 passage, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me in the life which I now live in the flesh. I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And Bill, see, this isn't enough for him. What does this mean? And we both knew what it meant. We'd both preached on it. We'd sliced it and diced it. We knew. But no, what does it mean to be crucified with Christ? So Bill says, let's pray it into each other. Now, I'm okay talking about this crucifixion stuff. But pray it? I says, okay. What do we do? He says, I don't know. You go first. And we're just seated like this. And he's asking me to pray for him. So I do. I come up behind him, and as best I could, I prayed, crucified with Christ. And when I finished, Bill, he's like this, and his eyes are huge, and he said, "It happened." And I said, "What happened?" And he said, "While you were praying, I could see Shepherd of the Valley Lutheran Church," his church. And he said, "It was packed. People in the balcony, people in the aisles, people up on the chancel, everywhere. And there was a casket in the front of the chancel, open casket." And he said, "I was watching the whole event through inside the casket." Now, this spoke powerfully into his own, what was going on about letting go, you see, dying to that. It was the biggest thing in the valley, and dying to that. It wasn't long after that that he did leave and began his lifetime work called preaching and prayer ministries. He would preach and pray. That's what he did. And we fell into a lifetime friendship. Even after he moved away to Seattle, Washington, there were just so many things, so many. I could tell you story after story of Bill. And I walked with him through the death of his wife, Marcine, and so many times we would make confession to each other, you know, to the Lord in front of one another and bring forgiveness and all kinds of experiences of prayer.
Wonderful, wonderful dedication. As we just put our toe in the water here and start talking about meditative prayer, how would you say, Richard, that meditative prayer fits into the larger picture of the biblical teaching on prayer in general?
Right. In general, prayer is our interaction with God about what God and we are doing together. I mean, people say to me, "I don't know what to pray about." I say, "Well, what are you and God working on together?" See? Oh, I hadn't thought of that. So prayer is that kind of interaction. Now, meditative prayer is the listening side of that relationship. We talk with God, and God talks with us. And, of course, learning to listen, that's part of the deal.
In fact, I found one of the most powerful sections of your book is in chapter 6, where you talk about listening, prayer, and you talk about the whispers of God, and then you ask, what might we expect to hear when we listen? Mm-hmm. And you go on to say, I would encourage you to be open to two things, the ordinary and the unusual. You say something more about that.
Oh, I must tell a story. This is both ordinary and unusual. It had been a hard year. I was living in the Pacific Northwest, Oregon. Been a tough year. And I wanted to take Carolyn, my wife, to the coast just for, you know, a few days. And I called and rented this room at a motel. I didn't know anything about it. It was just this little tiny place. But I find out later that this is a very famous place. There's some folks here from that area, Cannon Beach. Mm-hmm. And but anyway, we got in late at night. We go to bed. Next morning, I get up before the sun. And Carolyn's still sleeping, so I slip out. And now I was growing up many years in Southern California, so you don't have beaches where there's nobody, you know. And there, I mean, my only company was the tufted puffins and, you know, a few seagulls. And so I'm just enjoying this and the famous Haystack Rock. I didn't know it was famous. I just, there's this big monolith. And I remember saying out loud, I says, "This is beautiful." And it was like there was this response. I know, I made it. And I said, "Thank you, Lord." And there was kind of this response, "You're welcome." And I thought, God is here. So I thought, I have a few questions.
That's a good time. Take advantage of it.
And God was so gracious. And one of those questions, now all of this took maybe an hour or so, an hour and a half, was a question about relating to ministry and how I functioned in it and so on. And I was so intense about it, and I had this distinct sense of God laughing and saying, you know, sort of relax. Quit trying to be so blasted religious, you know? Oh, and I could begin to relax. And then I was given a quite wonderful sense of what God had in store. In some sense, I don't need to go into that, but that was such a moving time. But it was that laughter, the laughter of God.
Great.
It was so unusual to me.
Beautiful, beautiful introduction. This next question is a little bit of an aside, but how would you say, Richard, how would you say that meditative prayer, of which you've been speaking, how would you say that that differs from the practice of meditation in other non-Christian religions?
Oh, that's a wonderful question. The long, rich, wonderful tradition of meditatio is a long Christian tradition, and its centerpiece is the meditatio scripturium, the meditation upon Scripture. And it focuses its energies upon the filling of the mind and the heart and the spirit. Now, there is an emptying. Now, you all understand the Eastern stresses upon merging with the cosmic consciousness and emptying of the self. There is a kind of emptying. As Jesus said, you want the interior of the vessel to be clean. But the emphasis is always upon the filling. And I've made that little definition of Christian meditation to hear God's word, to hear God's voice, and to obey his word. Mm-hmm. And there is always in Christian meditation the ethical dimension of the transformation of the person in such a way that we obey, mm-hmm. we do something. Mm-hmm. And that's always a stress. And if you see people just looking for spiritual goosebumps, you know that they're not after this life.
And this is what encouraged me so much about your book as I read it, and I was continually taken to reference after reference in the scriptures and pointed to this notion of obedience, mm-hmm. not only knowledge, but obedience. Now, there's a sentence in your book that really caught my attention.
And boy, you are prepared.
Really?
I've
got a few questions for you. But
this worries me.
Now, here's what really caught my attention. It's where you identify the primary spiritual problem of our day. I said, wow. And I had to ask myself the question, what would I identify as the primary spiritual problem of our day? Now, you identify that problem to be Distraction.
Distraction.
Now, could you explain that?
If we are not able to be attentive to God, to be present where we are before God, we're in the worst possible situation. And everything in our culture pushes us toward distraction. We all face this. And of course, you can think of the normal things, the blogosphere and all that stuff. But internally, too, we have noisy hearts. And so learning, you know, the old Shaker song, 'tis a gift to be simple, gift to be free, 'tis the gift to come down where we ought to be, till we find ourselves in a place that is right, be a valley of love and delight. When true simplicity is gained, when they spoke of that simplicity, they meant that attentiveness. When true simplicity is gained, to bow and to bend, we shan't be ashamed. They would dance this. To turn, turn will be our delight, till by turning, turning, we come round right. Now, it's that coming round right. So people are really twisted around, and they need untwisting. And it is that coming round right where we can be available to God, attentive to God. See, God will not push himself on us. And he waits. He waits. You remember how Jesus said that we must be wise as serpents and harmless as doves? I always got that dove part. That sounded nice. But what is the wisdom of the serpent? It is the serpent can wait. Wait until the time's right to strike. So we must learn to wait in the presence of God. And you know, God is delighted. Here's the thing. At the heart of God is the desire to give and to forgive. God is not hard to get a hold of, but we've got to become attentive. So that's why it's so important today.
Wow. Yeah. What advice would you give to someone who is trying to practice the spiritual disciplines but is not that disciplined? How do you help people respond to the guilt and the frustration that arise when they fail to maintain their discipline, intending to get up in the morning early to pray, but sleeping in day after day? How do you help undisciplined people become more disciplined?
The first step at this is to know that we are not trying to master something. It doesn't work that way. How do you master something in which the very point is to be mastered? See? So we just let go of all of that sort of overachievement stuff. And see, loving God, the life that pleases God, doesn't come by gritting our teeth, but by falling in love. So, we learn the language of love. We learn to come lightly with open hands. We learn that none of us are disciplined and that we all need to learn ways. Now, the disciplined person is the person who can do what needs to be done when it needs to be done. See, most people, when they speak of discipline, they don't mean discipline. They mean rigidity. disciplines freedom. And it's learning to be appropriate in life. So we first relax and just simply, in the early days, see, I'd read that, you know, Francis Asbury was up at 4 a.m. pray for 2 hours. So I'd try that. And I kept falling asleep. So I would stand against a wall to pray. Do you know that you can fall asleep standing against the wall? And finally, I don't have to do that. And I come as I am. One of the old writers put it, Dom Julian says, pray as you can and not as you can't. And it's so important to pray as we can. I talked with the students this morning about not trying to be an overachiever at this. And see, the early ancient writers spoke about this, and they warned against spiritual gluttony because we're trying to conquer it all. So we pray as we can, and we'll learn step by step. And it comes easy. It's a grace.
I like the freedom that speaks to, mm-hmm. and I like the shared relationship with God that you're speaking of, the with God life. Sometimes people ask me, what do you think is the largest spiritual problem that faces Wheaton College students? And my answer to that question is, I think the largest problem facing Wheaton College students is that they don't know that God loves them. So how do we help one another when we identify that problem in each other, when there is apparently a conclusion that maybe God doesn't love me?
Yes. If we can learn to give a large measure of grace and mercy to one another, it will go a long way with this. I remember early on, I had gone off to some conference, and it was a good conference, learned a lot, and so on. And I came back, and I was telling a dear friend in our congregation, Dallas Willard, about it. And I said, oh, and by the way, Dallas, I made a decision at this conference that I know you've wanted me to do for a long time. And he stopped me right there. He said, no, that's not my business. My business is to bring, he never let me tell him what it was. He says, my business, my only business, is to bring the Word of God to you as best I know it, and then I'm to love you no matter what you do. You know, that absolutely set me free and allowed me to make a decision that I thought he might disapprove of. A year or so later. See, just that freedom with one another, grace and mercy, it gives a sense that God is full of this and that, oh, I don't have to have my defenses up. I don't have to prove to God how good I am mm-hmm. for And then I can open myself to be loved by God. See?
Well, keep your spiritual counselor's hat on there for this question.
Okay.
What's your advice for believers who have an ongoing battle with spiritual depression or the dark night of the soul? Mm-hmm. These believers who are struggling with spiritual disciplines, possibly, but finding no joy mm-hmm. in those disciplines, not experiencing mm-hmm. the presence of God. How do we support our friends who are finding these kinds of struggles?
Alice Fry is here, who works with people a lot on precisely these issues. Maybe, Alice, could you come and share a little on that question? I'll bring the mic to you. How's that? She had no idea I was going to do this.
So my passion is spiritual direction, which is the kind of relationship that Richard was talking about with Dallas, where when someone is depressed, there were a variety of words you used there, and they weren't all necessarily interchangeable, but I don't think information helps. I come from a battle with depression myself, and I remember having arguments with Bob when he wanted me to be hopeful, because you're supposed to be hopeful, and I couldn't be hopeful. And I think what brings healing often is an ongoing relationship with someone who loves you and is present with you in the sadness and the struggle that you're going through. So I meet regularly with people where I am way out of my league in terms of giving them information or helping them, but I can be there with them. And just this past weekend, I was with someone who was struggling with a tremendously dark place. And I have no idea what I gave, except my ears. But he seemed to be healed a little bit because of that time of loving listening.
Wonderful. Stone walls do not a prison make, nor iron bars a cage. And a lot of times, people are really locked up. And what can we bring in that context? Ourselves, our presence. That's what we bring. And we learn to be with people. I remember dear Bill and his wife, Marcine. Carolyn and I knew her well, and she died of ovarian cancer. We walked with him through that. And then 1 year later, he came to I invited him to come to a teaching week, and we taught together. It was in Los Angeles in a Latino context. He shared with me personally during that week was going to be the 1 year anniversary of Marcine's death. And he said, I know that it's irrational and everything, but I just have this fear that I'm going to die on the 1 year anniversary of, her death. So now I couldn't say this to anybody, but I was aware as we moved toward that day what he was battling with. And he had to share in kind of fits and starts. He was not emotionally, he's a very dynamic kind of person, but he was broken in a lot of ways. Well, when we came to that day and we taught through the day and then dinner, and not all of us, but several in that class were staying together in this dormitory setting, I got them all together. And we just started telling jokes and carrying on. And I got Bill laughing. And he laughed from probably 6 p.m. till about 10:30. It was just constant. And I just would do all these antics. And the students, they didn't know what was going on, but they were having a great time. So we were going on. And anyway, Bill, bless his heart, at about 10:30, he decides, he's had enough. And he goes in, we were sharing a room, bunk beds, it was very, not very nice. He lays down. and falls asleep just like that. And I actually had to go up and take off his glasses. He'd left his glasses on. And he slept, you know. Isn't that wonderful? We can give that to each other. And he's done that with me during deep times. We just give our presence to each other.
Thank you, Richard. We have not exhausted my questions, but we're going to turn the floor open to you all. We have a microphone there and a microphone here if you'd like to ask a question.
Yes, and anything is fine. We've agreed, I'm to take all the marshmallow questions, and Steve will take anything more difficult. So ask whatever you want. Here comes someone.
Hello. So this morning, you mentioned your Native American heritage, and I'm curious if Native American spirituality has had an influence on you.
That's a good question. For those who weren't there this morning, they were wondering about my hair. And so I just mentioned, and this is a more recent discovery for me. I had a grandmother whom I never knew. She died before I was born. My parents had always told me that she was French-Canadian, which she was, in a way. Lived on the Canadian side of the Great Lakes, Manitoulin Island. But she was Ojibwa. See, and they were embarrassed to tell me that. And it was our youngest son that found this out. His wife is Native American. So he found this out and shared that with us. And that's when I began to let my hair grow. So my knowledge of Native American spirituality is very, very limited. I've read some, know a little bit, but have a lot to learn. I think there is a mixture of things that are helpful and things that are not as helpful. Obviously, leaning into a pantheistic worldview, but also great insights. If you read the book Black Elk Speaks, there's an awful lot in there to help. But I know very little. I'm certainly no expert on it. Sorry.
Thank you.
Yep. Thanks for asking. Yeah.
You're welcome.
Go ahead. Okay. You can go ahead.
Hi. The first book I read by you is Money, Sex, and Power.
Okay.
I read that when I was doing my military service in Korea, when I was going through a really hard time, and I just never dreamed that I was going to be able to say personally thank you. So thank you.
Kamsahamnida.
You're welcome. And then I read Celebration of Discipline this year for one of my Christian education classes. And my question is, I found out that you can really engage in the spiritual disciplines when you are going through like a desert time. It's almost automatic. You are looking for fresh water from God, and you almost automatically engage in one of those disciplines, and then you start being healed, and you feel happy again, and you feel comforted by God. And then that starts building up, and when you become more and more content, I found that I tend to sort of lack the discipline as I become content. And I like wish that I had like a refresh button to be as desperate as I as I was when I was first starting it. Do you have any like advice on how to like have that kind of refresh button?
That's you understood the question? The ease by which we move this way when there's desperation and let go tend to. And it is the disciplined person who can do what needs to be done when it needs to be done. And to learn to live and to walk with God in abundance is an important thing for us to learn. And so, Steve, maybe you can help us know how to do that.
This is your program. This is the...
Can anyone help us a little? How do we work with this? A life of abundance in which we live in the joy of the Lord. Disciplines appropriate for that.
Yes.
What I found helpful for me is to use the imagery of a marriage or a romantic relationship. And just because things are going well and I'm having a high doesn't mean I don't connect with my lover. And so the lover of my soul functions in my life just like a human lover without the spats going both ways, the spats on my part. But that has helped me a whole lot sustain during the higher time.
That image is a wonderful one. And think of the interior castle. And how that, what's her name? Teresa of Avila used that image of the lovers. And when she gets to the seventh mansion, she uses very almost embarrassingly erotic language for union. And that is a place where we really can live in the joy of the Lord. Remember, and I'm sorry to make you stay standing, but just this, remember Paul's words that the life we live is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. And he included joy as part of that. So it isn't always... you know, that we have to be groveling and in pain to get to know God. We do it with joy. And Paul, you know, his words, I've learned, in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. I know how to be abased. I know how to abound in all ways, because I've learned that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That is, I can be abased, and I can abound through Christ who strengthens me. Does that help a little?
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you. Hi. About January of this year, I was listening to some sermons by John Ortberg about spiritual disciplines and the like, and being a typical Wheaton student or upcoming Wheaton student, I interpreted in a very overachieving manner and came up with my plan for 12 different spiritual disciplines I would engage in or whatever, and got an accountability partner. I was in a different country, and I got him to Skype me and ask me if I'd done them and things like that. So it's come as a great refreshment to hear you talking about being simple and not overachieving and not trying to be heroic. And what would you say are ways to discern practically, in a practical manner, between simplicity and laziness, or between heroism and appropriate commitment?
So. Excellent. Have any thoughts?
I'm the one that asks the question.
No,
you're the one that answers
the
question.
That's not the deal. When they ask the questions, we're together. We're joined at the hip on this. What was the question? Oh, yeah. You know, this friend, Bill Voswig, he was so good for me in that. He was able to discern every time when I was getting too, you know, serious, too icky. And he just had a way of, you know, putting the stopper on it. I told, can I tell him that story? Yeah. We were at this week-long retreat, okay, on prayer, Franciscan retreat place. And Bill says, well, we ought to pray for each other while we're here. Says, sure. And I'd brought along akin to a bishop of my tradition, superintendent, and I brought him, and he was dealing with some physical problems, and I said, Norval, come. His problem was he'd swell in different places, and when it would get in the throat, it would be actually very dangerous. And so we're going to pray for each other. Okay, so we go, and Bill prays for me, I guess. Norval prays for Bill. It's my turn. Here's the bishop. I'm a young pastor, see. And I get up there. I get behind him, and I place my hands. And I'm, this is the bishop. And so I got to really impress him. I mean, I got to have a really holy prayer. So I'm trying to pray. And when I came to Norval's physical situation, I can't remember. The doctors can't seem to figure out what's going on. Could you just clean out his whole system? Bill is kneeling down there, and he starts to laugh. And he says, if the Lord does that, he'll have the runs all night long. And I don't dare open my eyes. I'm trying desperately to redeem this. And I just say, if the Lord wants to do that, that's all right. And he says, whatever you say. Well, by that time, all three of us are just rolling on the floor. Well, that week, we had more fun. Bill had just been recovering from open heart surgery. And so we would take walks together, laugh together, carrying on, having more fun. I mean, this is a serious. The only people allowed were monks and religious and doctors were allowed. And we got in. The last night before the consecration service, there's a note on the door. It says, you two have been carrying on this whole week, laughing and, you know, and it's been ruining this conference for the rest of us who want to, you know, get to know God. And tomorrow is the final consecration service. Would you please, you know, stop all this frivolity? And it was signed, A Concerned Friend. I was furious. And I'm going, you know, if they just tell us, if they come to us, you know, we would have talked with them about that. And Bill, he's sitting on the little bed there. He's going, oh, they have a wrong spirit. We need to pray for them. And I'm pacing back and forth, more and more frustrated and angry that they didn't let us know who they were and so on. And Bill, oh, no, we just need to pray for them. And of course, he wrote the note. And he's trying to get me on my knees to pray. See, it was just that freedom to loosen me up. Now, the way he would help me to step in newer dimensions was just with his life. I never met anybody who could, you know, who knew how to listen to God. And this guy, he was not a type A person. He was triple A. I mean, he was, you know, a real and yet his able to bring all of that into an easy way of prayer and to teach me how to do that. So by that example, I learned the difference between those things. Does that help a little? Yeah. At least I got to tell a story.
Okay. In celebration of discipline, you recommend the use of imagination and mental pictures in prayer. I was deeply encouraged to hear that confirmed as a legitimate form of prayer because that's what I've always done naturally, and nobody I've ever talked to has understood that. But have you or anyone you know of who's practiced this found it, that this can impede the ability to pray out loud in groups?
To pray out loud?
Yes. If you pray mostly in pictures, how do you put that into words?
Well, maybe, I don't know. I just try to picture what could be and just to say, this is what I see. And Lord, this is the way it is to be. And ask the Lord. Let me just give an example. That may be help. When our son Nathan, he was just a little toddler, about 4 years old, and he was sick. And I went in to pray with him. And I talked with him about this sickness. I don't remember what it was, you know, some virus of some kind. And I said, now, it's like there's all of these soldiers, enemy soldiers inside of you. And, you know, they're attacking you. So let's ask Jesus, I'm going to put my hands on you, let's ask Jesus to send good soldiers in and to beat up all the bad soldiers. And, oh, he got into that prayer. And, I mean, we had, you know, a real battle going. But he went a little he went further than I would. He asked that Jesus, good soldiers that were released into his body, would beat up all the bad soldiers before morning. Uh-oh, I thought, I didn't say anything. Just, thank you, Lord, amen. The next morning, he came bounding in, jumped up on our bed, and he said to me, there are only 3 or 4 bad soldiers left. Now, that was his way of saying he was a lot better, but not perfect, and he wasn't sitting there worrying about why there were a few left. He just knew he was better, see? And I was, you know, uh-oh, what if it doesn't work, you know? And we can pray that way. I mean, we can just so naturally, if we see something, we pray it as best we can. And we always do it with humility of heart because we can get it wrong. Carolyn, my wife, is much better at this than I am. And sometimes I just sit back and watch this. How do you do this? How do you know this? I think she has a charism for it. I stumble along as best I can. But try to speak. Does that help you? No, it doesn't.
A little.
I don't know. Yeah, you'll learn. You'll find your way. And you don't always have to say things out loud. Not everything that you see needs to be spoken. You know this and you keep it to yourself. That's enough. The Lord will guide you. See, what I see is you have a good heart. You're not trying to impress anybody or make anything happen. And God will bless that. I see that in you. And that's a good thing. So be encouraged.
Thank you.
Okay?
There's a lot of good things here. But I want to give you the opportunity to differentiate what you believe and teach with some of the other contemplative teachers. So, for example, Thomas Merton, who you recommend in your book, said that contemplative consciousness is trans-religious, and in his biography, they said he had the most religious, most moving religious experience of his life in front of a Buddha statue in Sri Lanka, which you probably know. Mm-hmm. And then also, I was surprised to hear Father Thomas Keating, who is founder of Contemplative Outreach, say that the most advanced level of Christian spirituality, the Christian spiritual journey, is when we realize that we are one with God and that we have always been one with God, which goes beyond Christian orthodoxy.
Right.
So in your view, I think I've heard you talk about having union with God. In what sense do we have union with God during meditative prayer or when we go to heaven?
Right.
And also other contemplatives in other religions, like the Dalai Lama or something like
right.
that, are, in your view, can they go to heaven without rejecting Buddhism first and committing solely to Jesus, or can they go to heaven?
Well, there's a number of questions there, and I'm no expert on, you know, these other folks. I know who you're talking about. I have always tried my very best to stress a very high Christology that Jesus is the one that we come to. And isn't it gracious that God has provided a way for us? And so I try to point beyond myself to Jesus. That's where we want to point people, right? And if they would come, Jesus will be their teacher and will guide them. Now, in terms of other religious contemplatives in other religious traditions, I'm so glad it isn't up to me to make those kind of judgments about them. And I know that God can handle that situation quite well. So I'm happy to leave it in his hands.
And then the other question was, in what sense do you say we can have union with God?
Oh, the question of union, that's the kind of classic illumination, purgation, union. I had mentioned to the group at noon that I'm a little uncomfortable with the language of union. I understand what's being said. I myself find myself so far from that, you know, I'm just trying to get through today. But I listen to Teresa and some of the other writers and their experience, and I don't want to deny it, but it isn't exactly where I'm at. I'm, you know, stumbling along as best I can, and I have a long way before. But here's the thing. I would not argue for perfectionism, okay? And none of this oneness with God. I mean, all we have to do is look at ourselves for a minute or two. There was a group, it was a college, that had a motto that they were 30 miles from any known sin. And I suggested they might look into their own hearts. So, you know, that language is still uncomfortable to me, but I understand what people are saying. They are not talking about merging. There was always in the old writers, you become fully who you are to become, a person. You don't merge. I don't argue for perfectionism, but I do argue for progress. There's a long distance between, you know, just saved. What's that bumper sticker? Not perfect, just saved. Long distance from just saved to perfect. You know, there's a, and I want to say that we can make progress and grow. Remember Peter's words in his little epistle? Grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And that's what I want to argue for.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for the question. A good one.
I think we have time for one more. Oh, we have one here. Oh, I'm sorry.
Maybe two more.
All right, two more.
Two more.
Thank you for being here, Dr. Foster. I was following a rabbit trail on contemplative prayer a weekend or two ago and was surprised at some of the websites I came across that, at, you know, they seem to be Orthodox, evangelical people. And I was surprised at best the resistance to contemplative anything and at worst hostility. I mean, you know, and I was surprised how do you go about trying to reassure, or what do you do with that?
You just go on. Bless them. Mm-hmm. And but you don't try to convince anybody. There are certain people with certain kinds of agenda, and we must let them take that wherever they're going to, but we go forward. There are so many people so hungry and unafraid to come into this life. Now, there are, of course, dangers to be aware of, and, of course, guardrails, and the Bible's full of ways of helping us along. But having said that, we go forward with God. And what do you think? Yeah.
One more?
You have to fight over it, the two of you.
You had mentioned your thoughts on perfectionism, and I think that to a certain degree we work so hard to do a lot in our lives, and it almost becomes, like, for me, it's I struggle with obsessive compulsive disorder.
Mm. Sure.
And so there's this perfectionism mentality. But what do we do with Matthew 5:46 when Jesus says, "Be perfect as I am perfect"? Now, the way that I interpret it is that he gives us the Holy Spirit. Therefore, we are to trust in him to do every good work as he calls us to do. Maybe I'm answering my own question, but
yes.
What do you do with Matthew 5:46?
Well, no, you've given a good answer. And we live with that. I mean, remember, be perfect in love as God is. We can't, there's a lot of things we can't be perfect in. Mm-hmm. We're not perfect in knowledge. We're not perfect in understanding. We're not perfect in discernment of things. But we can come into that perfection of love that Jesus exhibited. So we watch, I mean, saturate yourself in the Gospels. See how Jesus worked with people. And then we seek to follow in his footsteps, as Peter said.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. It's a wonderful question. Almost a perfect question.
If you remember the first question that I asked, Richard, had to do with the title of the book. And I'd like to close by reading what you wrote in the closing word of your book. And you tell the story of being frustrated in finishing your book on prayer, experiencing overload, wondering if you could really put all of the research together into a book. And then something happened to you, something that you say, even today, I find difficult to explain. The only way, this is on page 150, Richard writes, "The only way I know to say it is, I saw something. What I saw was the heart of God, and the heart of God was an open wound of love. Then I heard the voice of the true shepherd, not outwardly but inwardly, saying, 'I do not want you to abandon this project. Instead, tell my people, tell my children that my heart is broken. Their distance and their preoccupation wound me. Tell them, tell my children to come home. And so I am telling you, as best I can, I am telling you that God is welcoming you, and God is welcoming me home, home to where we belong, home to that for which we were created. We have been in a far country. It has been a country of climb and push and shove. It has been a country of noise and hurry and crowds. And God is welcoming us home, home to peace and serenity and joy. We need not be afraid. God's arms are stretched out wide to take us in. God's heart is large enough to receive us. Welcome to the living room of God's love, where we can put on old slippers and share freely. Welcome to the kitchen of God's friendship, where chatter and batter mix in good fun. Welcome to the dining room of God's strength, where we can feast to our heart's delight. Welcome to the study of God's wisdom, where we can grow and stretch and ask all the questions we want. Welcome to the workshop of God's creativity, where we become co-laborers with God. Welcome to the bedroom of God's rest, where new peace is found. Jesus is the doorway into this home that is the heart of God, and prayer is the key that, by grace through faith, unlocks the door. Welcome home. Welcome to the sanctuary of the soul. Please pray with me. Lord God in heaven, we thank you for the time that we've had to converse this evening, to be sensitive to your presence and to your word and to your teaching. Lord, you have taught us this evening a little bit more about how to pray. Give us the energy and the imagination and the creativity and the love to keep asking the same question. Teach us to pray. And we pray our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks so much for coming this evening. There's the book table in the back, and Richard will be around here as long as he chooses to. You're dismissed.